Okay, welcome everyone. My name is Grzegorz Ekiert. I'm the director of the Center for European Studies and professor of government. And this is indeed my great pleasure to welcome Karen Donfried to the Center for European Studies. She has known the place for many years, our old location at 5 Bryant Street. So she's not a stranger to this. I have to say that Center for European Studies and German Marshall Fund of the United States are the sister institutions. We have a common father, and that person is Dr. Guido Goldman, who is the founder of the Center for European Studies, but also was a founder of the German Marshall Fund. So I think I'm very glad that that we can have our sisterly relations back on track. And part of this, of course, is the crisis in Europe, which brings families together. Now, Karen Donfried is the president of the German Marshall Fund of the United States, and she became a president in 2014. Before that, she was the special assistant to the president and senior advisor, senior director for European affairs at the National Security Council at the White House. Before that, she had a number of very influential positions in American administration, served in a national as national intelligence officer in National Intelligence Council. She was a German Marshall Fund member since 2001. She wrote extensively about German foreign and defense policy, about European integration, about transatlantic relations. And she has PhD from Tufts University and MA from University of Munich in Germany. It's a great pleasure to welcome you to the center, and Karen Donfried will speak about Europe facing crisis, America facing elections, what future for the transatlantic relations.
Well, thank you so much. It's really wonderful to be here. And I'm very grateful to you, Professor Ekiert, for the very kind introduction. And I also want to thank your colleagues at the center for the wonderful preparation in coming here. And before I start my substantive remarks, I do want to pick up on the point that I have a deep past here at the Center for European Studies. I had the good fortune actually to spend 3 summers at the center as a research assistant back in the 1980s. I was a student then at Wesleyan University, and one of my favorite professors, Andrei Markovits, had an affiliation at the center. And as you just heard, the center was then at 5 Bryant Street, a much more modest building than this beautiful building that we're in today. And Andy actually had an office in Van Zurg, this sort of cavernous office, where I spent 3 summers toiling away on German labor unions and the role of the Social Democratic Party. But then, as now, the center very much represented the country's premier community of Europeanists. So it really is quite wonderful to be back. And for me, of course, the center also, I very much connect with Dr. Guido Goldman. The organization I run today, the German Marshall Fund of the United States, would not exist, actually, without Dr. Goldman. It was his original idea to create GMF. But I first met Guido here in Cambridge, because at that time he was the director of the Center for European Studies. So it also is meaningful to me to be here because of that dual role, as you said, that Guido Goldman plays. Now, all that said, I don't want to talk about the past today. I want to talk about the present and the future. And my remarks will very much be oriented around policy, which is the world that I know best. And I'll be focusing in particular on the present and the future of the transatlantic relationship. And I just saw Peter Hall out of the corner of my eye. Peter, I hadn't seen you. I actually had sentences about you, and I didn't think you were here. But Peter Hall is someone else who I got to know back in the 80s. because Professor Hall was also affiliated with the Center for European Studies then. And not only did he make a wonderful intellectual contribution in those summers I was here, but I also remember him as being a wonderful personality around the center. So it's really lovely that you're here. It's not that. I just hadn't seen you out of it. I think it's my peripheral vision that isn't good. And of course, you're so lucky to have Karl Kaiser with you here, because Germany, I would argue, is the most consequential country in the European Union today. And you've got one of the leading experts on Germany now affiliated with the center. But in any case, you know, I think it's so important to talk about the transatlantic relationship in 2016, because Europe and the United States are longstanding partners, and I think it's really quite remarkable the challenge that this relationship is facing as we enter 2016. And just as we were chatting before we came down, you know, I said, who would have thought that we would begin this year with the two most successful projects of European integration, the single currency and open border, Schengen, being under extreme threat? Now, the crises that are engulfing Europe, of course, are not just those. They're multiplying. It's from refugees to Russia, from Brexit to Grexit. And of course, the US, as captured in the title, is in a period of consequential change, given the vagaries of a presidential election here. Now, if, as I believe, Europe and the United States are each other's foundational partners, what are the implications of these challenges for the continued vitality of the transatlantic relationship? And what I thought I'd do is unpack that theme around three interrelated issues. First, talk a little bit more about what are the challenges that are facing Europe, then put the spotlight on the United States, and then finally address the implications for the transatlantic partnership. So if we look at the challenges facing Europe, I think it's the simultaneity of quite significant crises on the European continent that is so daunting for Europe's leaders today. And I'm going to focus on four: the Eurozone, migration, Ukraine, and the broader relationship with Russia, and the threat of a British exit from the European Union. There are many additional topics which are worthy of equal consideration, whether it's the threat of terrorism on the streets of Europe, or the ungoverned spaces to Europe south, such as Libya, that provide huge challenges to Europe. But I'm going to limit myself to these four. We can cover some of the others actually in the discussion. With regard to the Eurozone, I would argue this is a crisis that is not yet over. It's been managed to date, but it certainly has not been solved. In the most recent chapter, which came to an end last year, Germany, as the Eurozone's largest economy, played the decisive role in securing a third bailout package for Greece. Without German support, Greece might have been forced last year to abandon the common currency, the euro. While some argued that Greece, given that it only comprises 2% of the Eurozone economy, could have left with little impact on the monetary union and the European economy overall, no one could predict accurately what the implications of a Grexit would have been. And there were many respected economists who warned of quite negative consequences of a Greek exit. For one, it opened the possibility that a country could exit the Eurozone. And that's a threshold that actually today remains quite significant. Greece's willingness to meet the terms of the deal for that third bailout certainly was paramount, but also that German commitment to European integration was another key element in forming Chancellor Merkel's support for that third package. I think it is difficult to find analysts who believe that the underlying problems or incompatibilities within the Eurozone economies have been fully remedied, and therefore we continue to keep an eye on that. And I think Greece will continue to struggle to implement the many reforms that it agreed to last year. Second, and in many ways related, we have the migration crisis. As all of you are very well aware, Europe is facing an influx of refugees and asylum seekers that has not been seen on the European continent since World War II. The German government alone estimates that roughly 1.1 million people equaling more than 1% of Germany's population, sought asylum in Germany last year. That number is quite staggering. And of course, the entire continent is struggling to deal with the influx. While Germany has accepted the largest overall number of refugees to date, Sweden, on a per capita basis, has actually taken in even more. All eyes are on Germany to see if Chancellor Merkel can galvanize the EU to forge a common approach and common policy to try to manage this issue both humanely and effectively. Today, as you know, the EU leaders are meeting with Turkey to try to make substantial progress toward a deal intended to manage better and stem the flow of migrants coming from Turkey into Greece. There's perhaps no European leader who is more eager for such an agreement than Chancellor Merkel, because she is now alone in her welcoming policy toward the refugees. And there was just a state election in Germany, but there are three more significant state elections that are facing the chancellor on March 13th. And we're sure to see the rightist AfD increase in support. And it'll be interesting and important to see what impact that has on the established parties, and in particular in Merkel's CDU. This is today that the elections in Hesse were the first time, and that will continue on the 13th, that we've seen German voters go to the polls since the height of the migration crisis has come into play in Germany. Now, the deal with Turkey, I think, is also important because it's unleashing unease in the European Union about Turkey's domestic political course. And many of you will have seen that on Friday, Turkish authorities seized Zaman, the largest opposition newspaper in Turkey. So again, there are several quite complicated issues coming together over the migration issue. One of the things that's striking to me is how different the alignment of the EU member states is on the Eurozone versus on migration. So you'll remember that during the heated debates over what was the correct Eurozone policy to pursue, Germany and Greece were at opposite ends of that debate. As Greece struggled to manage its huge debt burden, Germany delivered a tough message of austerity and structural reforms. Now turn to the refugee and migrant crisis. Chancellor Merkel most recently has made common cause with Greece, last week criticizing Austria and its nine Balkan neighbors that shut their borders. And she said other countries should not let Greece plunge into chaos. And she gave a television interview last Sunday where she said, "Do you seriously believe that all the Euro states that last year fought all the way to keep Greece in the Eurozone, and we, meaning we Germans, were the strictest, can 1 year later allow Greece to, in a way, plunge into chaos?" So the intersection and interrelationships of these crises is striking. The third crisis to add to this is the European Union struggling to respond to Russian aggression, most immediately in Ukraine. Up until Russia's illegal annexation of Crimea, the underlying assumption of post-Cold War US-European policy, namely that Russia had made a strategic decision that cooperating with us was more in Russia's interest than engaging in open conflict, proved quite simply to be wrong. The seeming inexorability of progress, even if slow, toward a Europe whole, free, and at peace was gone after that annexation of Crimea. So both Russian aggression in Crimea and the ongoing violence in the east of Ukraine instigated by Russian-backed separatists have upended the post-Cold War security order in Europe. In the United States, there was bipartisan unity in support of putting in place sanctions to punish Russia for its aggression and for this direct abrogation of the principle of rule of law. and to condemn the violation of Ukrainian sovereignty and territorial integrity. In Europe, the 28 member states of the European Union have different histories and present-day economic and political relationships with Russia. Thus, forging a common policy on sanctions was accordingly difficult. Chancellor Merkel became the pivotal figure in Europe in crafting an EU consensus to implement successive rounds of sanctions. I do not think you would have gotten there without her leadership. In Europe today, on the one hand, you have many voices calling for a return to a normal relationship with Russia, going back to business as usual, especially now with the refugee crisis, which results directly from the civil war in Syria. Some Europeans argue that the European Union should ease up on sanctions related to Russia's behavior in Ukraine in order to help commit Russia more deeply to a cessation of hostilities in Syria. On the other hand, in the US, President Obama is criticized for not doing enough to support the Ukrainians and punish Russia. The domestic debates are quite simply different on the two sides of the Atlantic. They're also different among the European countries. That said, the balance of opinion on both sides of the Atlantic holds that the unity of response embodied by close transatlantic cooperation over Ukraine has been a powerful counter to Russian President Putin, and one that most analysts think he had not expected. Many believe Putin thought he could divide the EU member states and divide Europe from the US after he engaged in that aggressive behavior in Ukraine. European leaders have made a clear link between the sanctions and full implementation of the Minsk agreements of September 2014 and February 2015 that call for a ceasefire, a withdrawal of all troops and mercenaries in Ukraine unlawfully, and call for full Ukrainian control over the country's borders. That linkage, I think, is quite clear, and I think there is a commitment on both sides of the Atlantic to keep those sanctions in place until those conditions are met. Now, the fourth crisis I wanted to talk about was the possible exit of the United Kingdom from the European Union. British Prime Minister Cameron has said that after having negotiated a better deal, as he calls it, for the United Kingdom in the European Union, he will campaign to prevent a so-called Brexit. We're now in the run-up to a referendum that he is now set for June 23rd, and that will be an in-out vote for British citizens. For the other 27 EU member states, the prospect of one of the EU's most important foreign and security policy actors and one of its key economic powers choosing to leave the EU is distressing at best. When Germany's finance minister, Wolfgang Schäuble, not known for being a softy, was asked last week about how Germany would react to Brexit, he replied, "We would cry." I thought that image captured both the distress, but also the sense of helplessness. At a time of global uncertainty, many analysts predict that Britons will not choose to leave the European Union. But there is much evidence to demonstrate that outcomes of referenda are extremely difficult to predict, and many factors can impact voters on the day that they go into that voting booth. The No campaign, the campaign calling for a British exit from the EU, now has a charismatic, populist and popular champion in the form of Boris Johnson, the Mayor of London. A further concern about a UK exit from the EU is the very real danger that this could lead to a breakup of the United Kingdom. because such a vote would likely result in Scotland pushing for independence to then allow a fully sovereign Scotland to apply for EU membership. So even just those four crises seen together are quite overwhelming for Europe. Now let's look at the United States. And here I titled this in my little notes here, The United States Adrift. So having painted a picture of a Europe overwhelmed by a multiplicity of crises, where do we find the United States in March of 2016? And here I want to highlight two issues that affect the transatlantic partnership from the US perspective. First, I would argue that we, Americans, have come to take our European partners almost for granted in recent years. And second, at present, we Americans are both distracted by our own domestic politics and uncertain about the future course of our foreign and security policy due to the vagaries of the upcoming presidential election. So on my first point, by the time Barack Obama was inaugurated as President of the United States, American policymakers seemed to be taking Europe largely for granted. The Cold War was over. The common transatlantic project of building a Europe whole, free, and at peace, a goal shared by successive US administrations, whether Democrat or Republican, seemed to be moving forward slowly but surely. The US was a supportive presence in the background, but by 2009, the real action was in the European Union's court, as it sought to conclude association agreements with the countries to the EU's east and Russia's west, and to extend that sphere of democracy, free market economies, and prosperity eastward. The Obama administration, as we'll all remember, was seen as turning its focus to Asia, announcing the pivot to Asia, which then became the rebalance. It was renamed because the administration was trying to make clear that it was not pivoting away from Europe, but that was nonetheless how most of our European allies heard that policy announcement. So we said it was really a rebalance because pivot was seen as you have to pivot away from someone. And so the argument was, no, it's a rebalance. And this is very much in Europe's interest as well because Europe has such important interests at play when it comes to China and other powers in Asia. Now, that being said, European allies remained very significant partners for the United States in difficult places like Afghanistan or on the most serious of diplomatic negotiations, like the P5+1 process to try to prevent Iran from acquiring a nuclear weapon that came to a successful end last year. But we Americans saw Europe very much as part of solutions. We took the success of the European project for granted. I would say that only began to change first for policy wonks when the severity of the Eurozone crisis hit. So people in the policy community working on Europe started thinking, maybe we need to be paying more attention to Europe as Europe. Look what's happening in the Eurozone. But a broader awakening about the seriousness of the crises affecting Europe, I would say, only became evident in the US late last year. And I just want to cite a few examples. Many of you may have seen the December 20th Sunday New York Times Magazine cover that had these wonderful, actually have it here, had these two large initials made out of stone. And you can see the stone is beginning to crumble, EU. And then the little caption is, has Europe reached the breaking point? Then there's something called the Eurasia Group, which is a political risk analysis firm based in Washington, DC. And at the end of every year, they put out their top risks for the coming year. And you know, people in Washington are always interested in what they say. And so at the end of last year, their top risk for 2016, the first risk, the number one risk, was the hollow alliance. And they made the argument that transatlantic partnership is now weaker and less relevant than at any point since the Marshall Plan, because American unilateralism and European weakness have undermined the alliance. So that was the first big risk, hollow alliance. Second, number two risk, a closed Europe. Arguing that while divisions within Europe, East versus West, old versus new, core versus periphery, were nothing new, those divisions were reaching a crucial point and challenging fundamentally the principles on which the EU was founded. I thought this was stunning, that the transatlantic relationship and Europe were the number two risks, above China, above ISIS, above Saudi Arabia. And then the third example I would cite, and final example I would cite of this, was an article that Tom Friedman wrote in late January of this year. The title was innocuous. I almost skipped over it. It was called Friends and Refugees in Need. But it caught my eye, and I started reading it. And the piece I thought was riveting, and I'm going to quote here from it. He starts off, now in his last year of in office, President Obama is in legacy mode. He has much to be proud of. But if he doesn't want his achievements muddied by foreign policy, he'll spend his last year redoubling his efforts to contain the Middle East refugee crisis before it goes from a giant humanitarian problem to a giant geostrategic problem that shatters America's most important ally, the European Union. I know putting European Union into the lead of a column published in America is like a do not read sign. Maybe I should call it Trump's European Union. That would go viral. But for the two of you still reading, this is really important. And then he continues on to talk about how the worst refugee crisis since World War II is eating away at the fabric of the EU. And then I have to read you this part because I really like this part. Why should Americans care? Because the EU is the United States of Europe, the world's other great center of democracy and economic opportunity. It has its military shortcomings, but with its wealth and liberal values, the EU has become America's primary partner in addressing climate change, managing Iran and Russia, and containing disorder in the Middle East and Africa. This partnership amplifies American power, and if the EU is hobbled or fractured, America will have to do many more things around the world with much less help. So I think in these three different examples, you see a United States waking up to the significant challenge that Europe faces, which directly affects U.S. interests. Here we have a presidential election campaign in the United States that is deeply worrying to Europe. Der Spiegel, the leading German news magazine, has called Trump the most dangerous man in the world. The British House of Commons, you may have followed, debated banning Trump from the UK. We have never seen anything quite like this. Now, I would point out that these same forces of populism that are fueling the Trump campaign are roiling European politics as well. So there are large swaths of both Americans and Europeans who feel their systems of governance are not delivering, who resent the growing income inequality, parents who believe their children won't achieve their standard of living, never mind exceed it. So that anger is fueling not only campaigns in this country, but also Marine Le Pen in France, or the AfD in Germany, the Sweden Democrats, the True Finns. I mean, you can look across the European continent. So the danger and concern there is that you could have a United States and Europe that are turning inward simultaneously. So I do think it is important to look at both sides of the Atlantic and the changes and challenges that we're both facing. Now, what are the implications of this for transatlantic relations? In a sense, why do transatlantic relations matter? Tom Friedman, I thought, gave an articulate argument about why transatlantic relations matter. We are each other's foundational partners. I would argue transatlantic partnership remains essential to stabilizing the global economy, for addressing the humanitarian crises of almost unprecedented proportions we see around the world. Ultimately, for maintaining the liberal world order that both continents have worked so hard to build and sustain over the past 7 decades. The challenges to that liberal international order are clear, and I do believe we will be stronger in meeting them if we act together. We cannot take the transatlantic relationship for granted or rest on nostalgia for the past. We need to reassess these ties and structure a relationship for the future. The strategic perspectives on both sides of the Atlantic are strikingly similar, marked by concerns about turmoil in the Middle East, with civil wars in Syria and Libya topping that list, also marked by concerns about Russian aggression in Ukraine, now complicated further by Russia's involvement in Syria, as well as global challenges like climate change, like cyber threats, and integration of rising powers like China into that liberal rules-based order. All of these challenges for Europe today have been eclipsed by the refugee crisis. Today's EU-Turkey summit is the next attempt to put in place a package of effective policies to stem the flow of refugees and migrants. The challenge for EU leaders is to craft a solution to the crisis that actually symbolizes, exemplifies the next big European project that can showcase the ability of the 28 member states to work together effectively. EU citizens need to be shown that there is a power in solidarity at a time when populism is running strong at the national level. It is a fact that the liberal international order that the US and Europe built after World War II is under challenge. Both the underlying principles of that order, whether rule of law or the fundamental freedoms, as well as the institutions of that order, the Bretton Woods institutions, the UN. This reality means that transatlantic cooperation remains critical. We have seen the power of that cooperation most recently in the successful conclusion of those P5 plus one talks on Iran. Our European allies do remain our most significant partners in meeting global challenges. Strong cooperation between the US and Europe has to lead to effective action in pursuit of common goals. It is not a given, and we have to build and tend it. In that vein, I want to offer 4 concrete and practical suggestions, 2 for each side of the Atlantic. For our European allies, first, I would encourage EU member states to redefine what solidarity means. To date, in terms of the refugee crisis, which is dominating headlines in Europe, solidarity has equaled putting in place a quota system to distribute refugees fairly across the European Union. This has led to a serious backlash, and not only in the countries of Central and Eastern Europe. Why not craft a broader definition of solidarity that allows all 28 member states to contribute to solving the crisis, even if the means they choose to address the crisis differ? Some countries may offer to accept refugees. Germany, I think, would. Sweden might, could come up with a list on her own. other countries might say, well, we're not willing to take in refugees, but we'll help this way. What could that be? Maybe they'd offer support to Frontex, the European Union's border control agency, whether people or funding. I think there are ways other countries could contribute that might be more palatable to their domestic publics. Second, as I noted above, the central roles that are played by Germany and Greece in both the Eurozone and refugee crisis strike me. And I wonder if those two countries could think perhaps about an unofficial grand bargain of sorts in which Germany would agree to offer limited debt relief to Greece in exchange for Greece accepting EU help to build up its external border and then help police that border. Such a suggestion has appeared in the press and was soundly rejected by German officials. But a private conversation, an offline deal, might actually provide each country with something it needs and wants. Because for Greece, of course, both of these issues get to the heart of sovereignty. And if there's a way to help bridge that, that might be a way forward. In terms of the Obama administration, two suggestions there. First, what unites all of the crises that I've listed is the fact that we in the US and also Europeans are caught in react mode. In each case, we are trying to avoid undesirable and damaging results. Things are happening that we don't want to have happen, and we're trying to figure out how to change that and solve those problems. That said, there is one proactive transatlantic project, and that is the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership. It's something that Americans and Europeans together agreed on and felt would be in our common interests, and we set out to achieve it. The debate over TTIP has become extremely contentious in certain European countries, with protests against everything from chlorine bleached chicken to something called the investor state dispute settlement, and it's become quite acrimonious. But if both sides of the Atlantic believe this agreement is in their interest, then we should work energetically at least to conclude the negotiations this year while the Obama administration is in office. That would leave a sound basis for a new US administration to work on that agreement being approved by the US Congress. And that TTIP point is related to my final point. The president is likely to make his two last trips to Europe in April and July of this year. I think likely his last trip to Europe will be to attend the NATO summit in Warsaw in early July. Prior to that, the president has agreed to go to Germany to attend the Hannover Messe, which is a big trade fair, in late April. The focus of the trip has been announced as advancing the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership. And while that remains critical for the reasons I just articulated, the context has changed in the intervening months. So the president will need to address this much larger set of crises now facing Europe. And he'll have to think carefully about what are the broader themes he wants to hit on that trip. He will be visiting Chancellor Merkel at a time when she is weaker than she has ever been. And he will certainly seek to support her, whether through declaratory policy on handling the refugee policy or by making specific policy proposals. And even though he will be standing in Germany, all of Europe is sure to be listening, and he can hit that theme of how powerful solidarity is in meeting a crisis that no one nation state can manage on its own. I would also suggest that the White House consider very seriously whether the president should include a stop in London on that April trip. A British exit from the European Union carries not only negative implications for the UK and for the EU, but also for us in the United States. While there certainly could be a backlash in the UK to a foreigner seemingly seeking to interfere in a national referendum, the president could make clear that this is a decision for Brits to make while laying out why the US sees its own interests at stake in the outcome of that referendum. My argument would be that it's better to be proactive on an issue like this rather than not to engage, given how high the stakes are for all involved. In a world that is changing in dramatic ways, the United States and Europe need each other. There are many forces at play over which we have limited or no influence. But we should marshal our resources to influence those that we can and to work for an outcome that ensures a continuing and long life for an international system based on democratic accountability, rule of law, pluralism, the right of citizens to determine their own futures, and borders that cannot be changed by force. So that would be the case I would make. I appreciate all of your listening, and I'm very much looking forward to the discussion. So over to you.
Thank you very much. This was a very rich analysis, and you covered a lot of territories. So I think that there will be important questions. I would like to ask you about the Middle East in this context. Refugee crisis is one of those forces tearing Europe apart, and it will not stop unless Europe and the US is able to stop the wars in the Middle East. Do you think that there is a chance, there is a way of thinking about coming together and trying to end the war in Syria and then the war in Libya? Is it realistic?
So it's interesting. I travel to Europe a lot, and I always ask Europeans, you know, we see how the refugee crisis is roiling Europe. Is there anything the United States can do that would be helpful? And typically the first answer is, well, you should take more Syrian refugees. And I say, well, you know, that's unlikely to happen. Let me explain the political dynamics in the US. But even if we doubled or tripled the number we were taking, it still wouldn't solve the problem. And then the second answer they give is, well, in that case, why don't you deal with the root cause and end the civil war in Syria? And I say, well, that's pretty complicated too. And I think you've seen the Obama administration engage very actively in a diplomatic process. We now have a cessation of hostilities that's held to date. I don't know if it'll become a ceasefire. I don't know if it'll hold over the longer term. And the reason I don't know that is because if you look at the countries who are involved in the civil war in Syria, the interests fueling their involvement are fundamentally opposed. So it's hard to see how we get to a diplomatic solution in Syria. President Obama has been very clear that he does not want to commit ground forces to what's happening in Syria. So we have been engaged in a very active air campaign, which is unlikely to be determinative of forces on the ground. So I am not optimistic about the civil war in Syria ending in the near term, which is perhaps unfortunate for Europe and the refugee crisis, but first and foremost, it's a tragedy for Syrians. And we have to remember that half of Syria's population has been displaced, either within Syria or outside. And Europe has a large influx, but let's not forget Syria's neighbors, that Turkey has over 2 million, Lebanon and Jordan each have about 1.5 million. So the tragedy of this for the Syrian people is the most consequential piece of it. And very sadly, I don't see a short-term end. Just one last point on this, which is even when that day comes, which I hope is sooner rather than later, that peace returns to Syria, the issue of migration will not go away for Europe. Climate change, not everyone believes it's real. I believe it's real. And it's going to be affecting sub-Saharan Africa in dramatic ways. So you are going to see migration from the south to the north, and that is going to affect Europe over the short, medium, and longer term. So regardless, Europe has to come to terms with what sort of refugee and migration policy it will put in place, and I would argue as a union.
Thank you. Carl, please.
Thank you, Carl, for this brilliant analysis. I find myself very much in agreement, both with the analysis and also with your prescription. I have a comment and a question. The comment relates to your remark that Europe and the United States have strikingly similar strategic interests. Mm-hmm. The trouble here is that we are now in the hands, and you refer to that, of totally unpredictable forces in domestic politics. If there is a President Trump, the strategic objectives of America would be very different. Yeah. And if, God forbid, Madame Le Pen comes to power, there will be a totally different Europe, as we haven't seen it for decades. Now, we don't know. We can only hope. There's very little we can do. The Europeans can do very little when it comes to the decision which is in the hands of the American voter, and vice versa. Perhaps the American president, and you were right to point out that it would be important, he has some influence on the Brexit question. I think an Obama speech in London will make a difference. But here's my question. You have four very good ideas at the end, mm-hmm. and one on the European Union relates to a sort of new arrangement on dealing with refugee policy. But shouldn't the European Union go beyond what you said? I mean, you said, let's redistribute the tasks. Not only mm-hmm. some countries take refugees, others can mm-hmm. support the Frontex or give money.
Yeah.
Hasn't the time come for a really very big deal? Because this is a global problem. The refugee move from south to north will only get worse. Yeah. You referred to the climate change. Yeah. That will make this into a much bigger problem. So the time has come to redefine possibly the whole relationship between mm-hmm. North and South, mm-hmm. and to redefine one's policy. And today they're discussing with Turkey how to help Turkey to keep the refugees there, or Jordan or Lebanon. So what I'm asking you is, shouldn't the EU be encouraged, and then perhaps with a sensible American administration, which we will hopefully have next mm-hmm. year, God help us.
you can knock on wood behind you. I don't have wood here, but I think
that you redefine the development policy,
yeah.
and of course also the policy yeah. on Syria. But the development policy is the key.
Yeah. So, I mean, Carl, that's a great point, and I certainly agree with it. The reason I'm starting where I started is because I've just been struck by how deeply divided the EU is today. I mean, I can't remember a time when the European Union has been this divided, or when Germany has been this isolated. I mean, the Eurozone crisis was also divisive, and there was a South-North split. But Germany was never alone. I mean, there was always a cohort of countries that were part of the policy Germany was pushing, and ultimately Germany prevailed, and there was relative consensus in the Eurozone about the way forward. This, you know, you've got Germany really almost alone. We tend to focus on Viktor Orban in Hungary or Fico in Slovakia as sort of the bad people who don't want to take refugees, but Manuel Valls, the French prime minister, stood up at the Munich Security Conference and said, we don't want them either. I mean, the split on the refugee crisis is so fundamental. And I just think you need some sort of confidence-building measure within the European Union to convince European citizens across all 28 countries that European integration can help them solve a problem, that they feel at home. You know, it's so interesting. You go to Germany and talk to people who say, oh, yes, you know, my kids no longer have sports after school, because the sport hall they were using is now housing refugees. So the refugee crisis isn't something out there like the Eurozone crisis was. It's something that many Europeans are feeling in their communities. And so I just want to start with something seemingly small, which is, can we convince European citizens that solidarity works, that they're better off if the 28 member states work together. Because what's happening today is these countries are putting in place national measures. They're putting back in place border controls, which is leading to a situation where you have this pileup of refugees in Greece, the least capable member state to deal with this. So I just want to start there and say, can we change the dynamic? And, you know, I have to say, as someone, I'm sure there are lots of folks in the room who follow the European Union very closely, and I was stunned last fall when European Union interior ministers got together and used qualified majority voting to decide on a quota policy for 160,000 refugees. So this is a drop in the bucket. And the reason I was so surprised by that is because usually in the European Union, you used qualified majority voting for things that aren't controversial, because it's just easier to do business. Okay, we don't need unanimity. We're just going to have a qualified majority move this forward. But the refugee crisis is incredibly sensitive in national political terms. So to say we're not going to have unanimity on that is why you had the backlash in Hungary, in Slovakia. And somehow you need to get everybody back on side, where they can say, okay, we all care deeply about refugees and about managing this humanely, but we're going to put in place different policies to try to move forward on this issue. So it may seem small, but it reflects how concerned I am about the division. Stop there.
Thank you. Manuel Muñiz from the Weatherhead Center. I have two questions on issues where I think the Americans and Europeans disagree to a large extent. One is China, that you did not mention, of course, because I think the crises in Europe are so significant and so severe right now. But I worked on a project in which the GMF was involved called Trans World on Transatlantic Relations, and we conducted a very large elite survey in a number of European countries and in the US, and on a number of security issues. It was 1,200 elites. We asked them about security issues, trying to find agreement or disagreement. And the only issue on which we found major disagreement was actually the nature of the rise of China. With, you know, to the question, is the rise of China a military threat to your country? Around 30% of European political elites said yes. That figure was much closer to 70% in the US. We asked about NATO, the use of drones, the war on terror, all sorts of things where we thought we would find disagreements. Almost across the board, there was agreement except the rise of China. Mm-hmm. So how do you think we can work around these issues? Is there a structured mechanism for dialogue on these issues? Should one be set up? Because this is sort of an underlying trend, right? Perhaps the most significant strategic development of the 21st century, and we're starting from very different perspectives. At the political elite level, at the public opinion level, it's much more similar. And the other issue is Libya, that you mentioned, but only in passing. And that is because it seems to me that the urgency and the significance of the Libyan situation is much greater for Europeans than Americans. The Americans have deployed special forces, and some Europeans have. I was involved with UNSMIL last year quite intensively in the mediation effort, and you could see it in terms of the diplomatic presence and the, you know, how worrying it was for a number of states, particularly for Italy, to some extent the UK, not so much Germany. So I was wondering what you thought could be done at a transatlantic level there, whether the US could contribute to the solution of the crisis, what you think the solution to the crisis might be. I'm pretty sure it's not just special operations in the country, but much more sort of longer term efforts of state capacity building and others. But on that issue as well, we seem to start from very different perspectives, with the Americans taking much more of a position that is mainly a European problem, but for Europeans is, to some states like Italy, very an existential threat.
Yeah. So first on China. So I talked a little bit about how I think one of the overarching challenges that binds the US and Europe is the maintenance of the liberal international order. And when I talk about that, I see China as one of the major challenges to the continuation of that order. And I think what's happening in the Middle East is really important. I think what's happening in North Africa is really important, go around the world. But I think there is nothing more fundamental than the rise of China for both the US and Europe. And I think we should be spending a lot more time engaging on it in the transatlantic relationship. And the data that you cited, I think, shows that the U.S. has a much broader relationship with China than Europe does. So for Europe, the relationship to China is overwhelmingly economic and driven by business. For the U.S., we have a fundamentally important economic relationship with China, but we also have real security concerns in the region. We have allies in the region. So there's a foreign and security policy dimension to the U.S. relationship with China that is simply absent for Europeans. And I think that shows in the survey results you cited. So, you know, when you think about the economic relationship, it's also very interesting to unpack European relationships. If you look, for example, at European Union exports to China, and the numbers I have in my head are probably from maybe 2013 or 2014, they're not the most recent ones, but I don't think it's changed very much. Germany dominates. About 40% of EU exports to China are German. And then you drop down to the UK and France at maybe 10 and 8%. So you also have very uneven relationships to China within the European Union. So the Chinese actually tend to give a lot of priority to their relationship with Germany over and above anything they do with the EU. And we saw David Cameron, I thought it was a little bit embarrassing about why he opened the door to China most recently, to secure economic deals, looking for growth in China. That's not a good place for us to be in the transatlantic relationship, where there's a competition to have better economic relations with China. And you saw this play out on the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, right, where you had different policies in the U.S. and Europe. The U.S. was making the case that it was better not to become a member of the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, that China was not going to have the same high standards that we have in the World Bank, that we should stay outside. The Europeans ultimately decided they disagreed with that, and they thought it was better to be a member of the AIIB and try to influence Chinese behavior from inside the bank. And that even got competitive among the Europeans. So I remember this vividly. This was March of last year. On the Friday, the UK announced that it was going to join, and then the other Europeans followed on the Monday. You know, it's fine for the US and Europe to come to different policy decisions. That will happen. You know, there can be honest differences, but we should have managed it better in the relationship rather than having, I mean, I remember the headline, I was in Brussels at the time, the headline in the International New York Times was U.S. and Europe split over AIIB. It's like, oh, you know, that's not a good thing. We should manage the difference so that we say we've talked about this and we've reached different decisions. And the problem, I think, is that we don't have a good place to have that transatlantic conversation, right? You're not going to really discuss it in the European Union because the European Union, yes, you have Federica Mogherini, who's doing a great job, as did her predecessor, Cathy Ashton, but China policy isn't in the purview of the EU. You're not going to discuss it in NATO, so you discuss it in bilateral relationships, but that makes it hard to coordinate across more than one country. So, I mean, I will... to plug GMF, you know, we're making a small contribution to this in that about 7 years ago, we started a trilateral forum that brings together Americans, Europeans, and Chinese twice a year. And the first day, it's just Americans and Europeans, and it's a mix of policymakers, think tankers, academics, and then the second day, Chinese participants join, and it really bugs the Chinese. But that point is that we in the transatlantic relationship need to have a conversation about what the differences are and how we see China. And then, you know, we bring the Chinese in. But I think there's so much more work we need to do on that. And it's hugely in the interest of both sides to have that greater focus in the relationship.
Thank you. Lucas, please.
Thank you very much for a very interesting talk. I suppose, being Greek, the obvious thing for me would be to comment on your grand bargain between Greece and Germany, but I shall not.
Oh, God.
And I would much prefer instead to comment on 2 points you made near the end of your talk. Mm. You spoke, first of all, about a common trend on both sides of the Atlantic towards political extremes, the rise of populism in both Europe and the United States. And then you proceeded to add, obviously, that both Europeans and Americans should continue to defend the liberal order. Mm-hmm. But the two are obviously related.
Yeah.
Because unless we recognize that something or many things went fundamentally wrong with the management of the liberal order until now, we do not recognize why there is a rise of populism and the shift to political extremes in both Europe and the United States. Unless we recognize, for example, that a large percentage of our populations do not benefit from this liberal order, or they do not recognize as benefiting mm-hmm. from this liberal order, unless we recognize that the financial crisis was one of the biggest political and economic failures of decades and draw lessons from both of them, then we will not be able to defend the liberal order. Mm-hmm. So that would be my comment.
I completely agree with that. So I think that strengthening of that liberal order is not just about foreign security policy. But the only way that order is appealing to others who are not a part of it is if they see that model as successful. And that model, if it's not deemed successful by the citizens of that order, it's certainly not going to be very attractive for those outside of the order. And so I think there's a huge task that we have at home in terms of, you know, what, how have we failed our citizens? And you know, it's, I mean, I think it's going to play out on several different levels. You know, if Trump ends up being the Republican nominee and Clinton ends up being the Democratic nominee, you know, there, you have to accept that there's also a possibility that Trump wins that election. I mean, right? But let's for the moment postulate that he doesn't. I think there is going to be a very serious coming to terms with what's happened inside the Republican Party. You know, I mean, a lot of Republicans I know really believe they should win this election because you've had two terms of a Democratic administration they think has failed. So essentially Hillary Clinton's running for a third term, which is hard in the best of circumstances, and these aren't the best of circumstances, and we know that she's a vulnerable candidate in her own right. So it's this whole complicated mix of things that, I mean, Republicans really believe they should win. And if they don't, and given the civil war that's playing out in the Republican Party, you know, I think you're going to see a reckoning there. And also on the Democratic side of the aisle, I mean, what's fueling Bernie Sanders' campaign is that same anger on the left. So it's not just on the right of the political spectrum. It's, you know, across the board. And we see that in Europe, too. So in Greece, it's more political populism near the left. You see it in Spain. So, you know, it's on both sides. And it does have to do with a system of governance that substantial swath of the public feels is not delivering for them. And, you know, it's making me think of at the last European Parliament election, what, 30% of the European Parliament is now comprised of Eurosceptic parties, right? And so I would see people in, you know, European parliamentarians or people in the administration of the European Parliament say, wow, this is really concerning. Oh, no, don't worry. It's only 30%. You know, 70% is, and it's like, right, but if that's the trend, you know, it's going to, unless you address it, it's going to keep growing. So absolutely. I mean, you've got to deal both with the internal dynamics that are at play as well as then the role that you're playing outside your own borders. But absolutely agree.
Peter.
Oh, thanks. I too thought your suggestions were very sensible. I want to ask you about the immigration crisis from first a European and then an American, the American side. On the European side, I basically want to ask what your impressions are about what this crisis and maybe the Euro crisis is doing to German opinion, elite opinion, and public opinion about the value of the European Union and what it offers them. When Mrs. Merkel first made her statement and opened the floodgates, a young German scholar who was visiting me said how wonderful this was. You know, this reflected sort of the best that the country could be, and you know, saw this as a turning point in some set of values. Well, since the episodes in Cologne and more recently, and we know the alternative and are going to do relatively well in the regional elections on Sunday next week. So I'd welcome hearing from you a little more about what you think we might be seeing and might see in the coming year or two in Germany's views towards the EU and Germany's views towards the EU. What do you hear? The euro crisis is also in some ways not that great for that. The view that, the EU is giving us a southern albatross, we have to pay for them, et cetera, even though in my own view the German effort to impose economic policies that are appropriate for Germany on a continent for which they're not so appropriate, it is a lot of the problem. Mm-hmm. So that's the European side of the question. Mm-hmm. The American side of the question is as follows. So to actualize the bargain that you suggested between Greece and Germany requires Germany to give debt relief to Greece, which I certainly think would be a good idea. As you know, the IMF is resolutely opposed to that. The German Bundestag, under its current legislation, can't go along with that unless the IMF is involved. Do you think the U.S. Has enough influence with the IMF to shift the views of the IMF, and do you think it would use its influence that way?
Okay. On your first question about German views of the EU, and I'm shy about answering this with Karl Kaiser sitting right there. So I think that there is no country to which the European Union is more important than Germany, because European integration was such an important part of Germany, how Germany found its way back after the end of World War II, and that European identity is so important for Germany. You still see a very deep inhibition to lead in Germany. I mean, there's no question that Germany is the leader of Europe. It led on the Eurozone crisis. It's leading in every one of the crises I mentioned. But Merkel always wants to be with others, whether that was in the Eurozone crisis, in the case of Ukraine. She created the Normandy process with François Hollande, and you sort of feel like Hollande is being pulled along by the scarf rather than really being an equal partner of Merkel's. But she doesn't want it to be just Germany. And with the refugee crisis, that's one of the things that's so difficult for Germany, being alone. And it makes me think of this review process that the German Foreign Ministry concluded in 2014. And that review process grew out of a conversation in Germany where President Gauck, the German foreign minister, the German defense minister had all appeared at the Munich Security Conference in 2013 saying Germany needs to take on greater foreign policy responsibility. And then they had to figure out, well, how do you move the German public to embrace that? So they started this review process, which included town halls across Germany. And the report that resulted, on the cover of the report are three words: crisis, order, Europe. And so as Germany is faced by crises, it wants order, right? It wants order to deal with these crises. And Europe is the key to that order for Germany. So if Europe isn't effective, that is hugely troubling for German officialdom, but I also think for the German public. So I do believe that this confluence of crises is very unnerving for Germany, because of the role that Europe has played. What strikes me is, you'll remember that at the time of German unification, a lot of people link the creation of the euro, of the single European currency, to unification, that in some ways it was all part of the bargain. That, if France was going to agree to German unification, then essentially Germany needed to agree to that single European currency. Because you could kind of argue there had been a single European currency called the Deutschmark. It's just that no country other than Germany had an ability to control it. So that it was really Germany giving up sovereignty and creating the euro. And at the time, Helmut Kohl said, in support of the euro, that he was committed to creating a European Germany, not a German Europe. And I think a lot of Greeks and a lot of other Europeans today actually think the euro resulted in creating a German Europe. So it's really fascinating how all of these things are playing out. But, you know, I think especially with Merkel, where people weren't sure about her commitment to European integration, she grew up in the East, she didn't have that background, it's turned out that she doesn't want to be the chancellor that sees Europe go down the tubes. To your second point about this sort of potential bargain between Greece and Germany, Peter, I may have this wrong. So I actually thought that the reason the IMF had been reluctant to support that third bailout was because the IMF was actually very supportive of debt relief. And I thought it was IMF economists that had said this debt burden is unsustainable. There is no way on this earth that Greece could ever pay it back. And because the Germans wouldn't agree to that, the IMF was holding back from it, so I actually think the IMF is very supportive of. But so, you know, I don't think that would be the issue. I mean, you talked to
the
Bundesbank is not.
The Bundestag is the issue. It's a big problem.
Yeah, there's no German that supports debt relief because they think it's sort of encouraging the Greeks to engage in bad behavior. I think that, you know, you have a very clear agreement with the Greeks about very difficult structural reforms they need to put in place, among the most sensitive around pensions and other things. So I think it is good for Greece to put in place those reforms. So I don't think you want to let up on that, but I think just, you know, acknowledging that Greece is never going to be able to pay back this debt burden. So let's just be honest about that. And I'm not saying do away with all of the debt, but relieve the debt. Give a little breathing space. And again, I think it's very hard for Germany to do that in any public way. But it seems to me that there's an opportunity, perhaps, for Greek and German officials to have that conversation. I actually think the most difficult piece of that is maybe not the Bundesbank or the Bundestag. I think it's that the personal relations are so poisoned at this point between German policymakers and Greek policymakers. And so, you know, the question is whether there's another party that could be helpful in moving those relations forward. And my thought was that maybe the refugee issue could be a platform where there are shared interests that sort of allows you to move forward in a more constructive way. But, you know, maybe not.
Please, sir.
Thank you for your marvelous presentation. One element that I'd like you to think about is how the U.S. interaction with Russia. I'm thinking now about what's going on in Syria, where we may implicitly be saying, well, we can have a detente with the current, with the Syrian administration and divide it as a way of clearing that. And speaking to Europe/NATO fears of Russians' eastward movement could play into maybe a resolution of these problems and what the U.S. could do in that regard to help bring the European Union more strongly together.
So, you know, the policy toward Russia has, I would say, three components sort of in the wake of Ukraine. I mean, there was one piece of it, which I talked about, which was really focused on sort of punishing and isolating Russia, like making clear there are costs for what you've done. Always a part of the Russia policy was offering a diplomatic off-ramp, basically saying to Russia, so as long as you continue to occupy Crimea and encourage separatists to engage in violence in the east of Ukraine, there are costs for that. But at the same time, we're continuing to talk to you because we'd like to resolve this, and there's this diplomatic off-ramp. The problem there has been that Russia has shown no interest in taking that diplomatic off-ramp. The other parts of the policy, one has been the reassurance initiative through NATO, where, you know, our Central and East European allies really felt threatened by Russia. And the Baltics are particularly vulnerable, but it's not just limited to the Baltics. And so you saw the U.S. step out very quickly in the wake of the annexation of Crimea in buttressing forces on NATO's eastern border. And then the rest of the alliance backfilled. I mean, we were just able to act more quickly. And then, of course, you had the Wales summit in the fall of 2014. That was a moment of solidarity within the NATO alliance. And we'll see what happens in Warsaw this July, the Obama administration, of course, has already come out announcing a $3 billion package of support for the European Reassurance Initiative that does need to be approved by the U.S. Congress. But I think the U.S. has been quite robust in wanting to make clear that the Article 5 commitment in NATO is real, and we will stand by those allies. The third piece of that policy has been supporting Ukraine and saying, you know, this is a place that faces real security threats and also real economic challenges. So there's an IMF package in place for Ukraine that the U.S. and the Europeans have been very supportive of, $17 billion, that frankly may not be enough. Because of, you know, the east of Ukraine is the manufacturing heartland, and that's where you've had war going on. And then Ukraine has real political issues. I mean, there's corruption that Ukraine is trying to tackle with limited success. The government currently is quite shaky with President Poroshenko and Prime Minister Yatsenyuk. But frankly, there would be nothing more powerful than a successful Ukraine. but that's a pretty hard thing to get in the short term. And so I think there we're really going to have to stay the course. And, you know, Putin is a very difficult person to deal with. I'm not sure any of us fully understand what Russia is after in Syria. I think clearly Putin was interested in stepping back onto the world stage, showing that he's an actor that we, the U.S., and others need to deal with. Russia clearly has its own interests in Syria. I mean, that its one warm water port is there in Tartus, which clearly it wants to defend. And I don't think Putin's actually that attached to Assad, but I think he sees Assad as someone who will look after Russian interests in Syria. But the indiscriminate airstrikes that Russia has been engaged in Syria, again, I mean, the first victims of that are Syrians, but I don't think there's any question that those Russian airstrikes have increased the refugee flow into Europe. And I think Putin is fine with that, in his eyes, ancillary benefit of the campaign in Syria. So, you know, I don't know that anyone has sort of figured out how to engage Russia in a way that makes it a more constructive actor in this space. And I think it may be a longer-term challenge for Europe and the U.S. And, you know, it's not clear that a weak Russia is easier to deal with than a strong Russia, because I think in many ways Putin is acting outside Russia's borders to enhance his popularity within Russia's borders. So there are various motives he has for engaging in this. So I wish I had a good, constructive path for us to follow. But I think it's going to take lots of diplomacy and also some hard power to try to influence what's happening.
You are very modest in suggesting new things Europeans should do to be able to at least alleviate some aspects of the crisis. And when I read in the evening, the news coming from Europe, I'm frustrated about two things. At least about. I see a lot of articles in the press which are very critical about the policies of the European Union in various aspects, with the titles "Europe Needs Plan B." And then, you know, you read this whole criticism, and the moment you expect to read what that plan B is all about, the last sentence is, "And Europe needs the plan B." So that's one thing. And the second thing is that, you know, whatever issue shows up on the agenda, the reaction of the policymaker is to drag the prime ministers or finance ministers to Brussels and try to make a deal of one sort of another, right? So my question would be this. Do you sense any plan B showing up in conversations in Europe? Is there any real alternative to many of the things which have been the standard ways of dealing with issues like, you know, Eurozone crisis or something else? And do you see any new policy proposals which somehow broaden the decision-making process about difficult issues and taking it away from the prime ministerial office. You know, what I have in mind, for example, is, you know, the Polish church, regardless of all the pernicious things the Polish church does in the country, had this nice idea a few months ago to say in the parishes across Poland that every single parish should adopt one Syrian refugee. Mm. And that's not such a big deal, that the priests were sort of, you know, very open about this. Has anyone thought, for example, about the idea of bringing all the religious leaders from Europe to Brussels and say, maybe you have some idea of how mm-hmm. we can deal with certain issues? So involving civil society organizations mm-hmm. on much broader scale and moving away from this sort of very bureaucratic way of managing crisis mm-hmm. May have some beneficial effect.
Yeah. So, you know, what is the plan B? You know, one thing that's so striking about the refugee crisis is it should not have been a surprise. So this was a long time coming. And if we think back to March of last year, I remember a European Council meeting, speaking of dragging everyone to Brussels, where the Italians, Prime Minister Renzi, was screaming about the refugee crisis. He was saying, we in Italy cannot manage this. And he was calling for solidarity. You all need to help Italy. And what happened? The other leader said, sorry, you're on your own. And he stormed out and said, if this is solidarity, I don't want it. And you fast forward just several months, and it's Germany that's calling for solidarity. Now, that is understandable to me, because what happens for policymakers is the urgent always pushes out the important. So what was urgent for Germany in March was the third bailout for Greece, and all eyes were on how to prevent a Grexit and or how to manage this. And so people just weren't focused on what clearly was coming. You know, there's been so much criticism of Chancellor Merkel for her standing up and saying, you know, we can manage this. I mean, honestly, what political leader gets up and says, we cannot manage this? To me, that's not really political leadership. I mean, and of course Europe can manage this. I mean, Europe's a continent of 300 million. Europe can manage this. I don't think it's that hard to see what you need to do. And essentially, Europe is doing these things, but very slowly and in a not terribly coordinated way. I mean, you do need to buttress Europe's external borders. I mean, if there isn't an external border, then you can't control who's coming in and out of your country or your continent. So that is a first-order issue. It's striking that $3 billion is going to Turkey or is on offer to Turkey, and yet Greece is getting, I think, several hundred million to help with its border enforcement. It seems to me that the European Union has to grapple very seriously with its external border. So that's one thing. And I think accepting that member states have different capacities to deal with that. And I think there's real wisdom in having an EU border force so that you have equal enforcement. I mean, this is something, let's be honest, the US has come to terms with over the past decade. We have very substantially reinforced our southern border. There's no question about it. And this is interesting, too. I actually think there's a lot of transatlantic learning that can happen here. At some level, these are fundamentally different issues, but there are interesting parallels. So there's EU's external borders. Then, you know, I don't know if I were a member of the European Union, I would want to put my destiny in Turkey's hands, and I certainly wouldn't want to do that at the cost of not speaking openly about Turkey's democratic path. But it is true that when you're dealing with refugee flows, you do need to be looking at countries through which they're transiting. Again, look at the US. You'll all remember we had a spike in Central American refugees coming into the US, and we worked diplomatically with Mexico and with many of the countries in Central America to try to help manage that migration flow. So yes, I mean, the EU does need to work with the countries of North Africa and with Turkey on how you manage this. So I do think that there are pretty clear policy elements to this, and they have to be seized, and you have to move forward on them, because the problem when a leader stands up and says, we can manage it, then you have to manage it. And your idea about bringing in civil society, I think, is very powerful, and that makes sense. But we also have to accept or acknowledge the reality that Peter Hall mentioned, which is when Merkel first stood up and said, you know, we are going to be open to these refugees who are stuck in Hungary, there was a wonderful reaction on the part of the German public, and we all remember this, you know, Germans gathering at train stations to welcome the refugees and volunteering at all of the new shelters that were opening up in their towns and cities. And that still is there, but there's a growing frustration and exhaustion with the issue, and that's the thing. So I think there is a very important role for civil society in this, and for volunteerism, and for engaging religious leaders who can also provide a different lens on this. But I think ultimately it is going to fall to governments at the city, state, national level to assure citizens that they are managing what is a very rapid influx of people who have real needs. So I think maybe it's you know, all of the above, but not enough is being done. And I'm not sure how much time there is, which is why I would say yes, you know, any idea like that of bringing religious leaders, do that, because the more people focused on a solution, hopefully the sooner you get to that thought through whole policy response.
This was an enlightening and very important conversation, and we are very grateful that you share the ideas with us, and hope to see you more often at the Center for European Studies. We have reception upstairs. You are all invited to it to continue the conversation. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.